ओम शांति। यस्टरडे आई सेड दैट देर आर थ्री कैटेगरीज ऑफ पीपल, दोज हु बिलीव इन गॉड, गॉड बिलीवर्स, दोज हु डोंट बिलीव इन गॉड, गॉड एथिस्ट, एंड दोज हु आर नॉट कमिटेड, नॉट येट फाइनलाइज्ड, बिकॉज दे थिंक देर इज नो clinching and concluding evidence, and they are called agnostics. So I had mentioned, still each one of them believes in certain values. Those who are believers, some of them having philosophical bent of mind, they also believe in certain values, and it is for those values they seek God. And they find that God is the one who has those values inherent in him, and they believe in God. Those who are against this belief, they think that those values are violated. The concept of God which is generally given to them, they think it is in contravention to what the believers want to assert. So therefore they reject those arguments. But all the same, they also believe in some values. Why I say this is because we should know which is the foremost value in the person whom we are dealing with. Why he is interested or disinterested in God, either way. And I also mentioned about bhaktas. I was continuing with it, and we concluded it because of the constraint of time. And I had mentioned certain kinds of bhaktas, why they worship God, seek God, invoke God, want to have some link with God, so on and so forth. Some thinking that they have sinned, and therefore they are sinners. Oh God, have mercy on me. Thinking that God is the purifier, no one else can liberate from the sins. Because even in Christianity also they think that they believe in the original sin. That burden of the original sin is being carried on by every human being. The Adam having taken the forbidden fruit. That they call as the original sin. Other sins follow. And Baba also says, Kamat Krodho Bujayate, other vices are born from sex lust. Of course, that also is born from body consciousness. In their case also they say man became body conscious. They found they are naked. They wanted to cover the body. And then they ate the forbidden fruit, disobeying God, that they should not eat. So that was the original sin which everyone is carrying. And how can they liberate? Anyone who is sitting in the chair, he cannot lift the chair in which he is sitting. Someone else, if someone is tied to a tree, he cannot open the knots of the rope with which he is tied to the tree. Someone else who is not tied up, he alone can liberate this person who is in ropes, tied to the tree. So they think that they are sinners, and therefore they pray to God. We are not able ourselves, by our own efforts, however sincere, however hard, to liberate ourselves, our mind, our consciousness, from sins, whatever be their form. So you, being merciful, do mercy on us, pity on us, and liberate us. Others say other things, some of which I had mentioned. And just mentioning some of these, just that you may be aware of the link from which we will be now taking up today. And some of them say, God, lead me from mortality to immortality, from darkness to light. and from unreality to reality. They think they are the three causes of all our sufferings. Certain things which are unreal, illusion or delusion, out of our fault, our ignorant, our wrong thinking, wrong understanding, or the human nature as it is, our shortcomings, we consider them as reality. And that is what takes us to something which we call evil. Therefore, they say, "O God, lead us from this." The others, then they say, "From darkness to light. Who am I? Where from I came? Where am I to return to? What is my goal? What is my role? I am in darkness, total, utter darkness, stark darkness, I don't know. Therefore, you, the most enlightened one, who are knowledgeful, please remove my ignorance, my darkness." They think enlightenment is the main thing. Light is the main thing. And also, one of the major causes is of human beings, all of them without a single exception, being mortal beings. Anyone who is born must die one day. No one has ever lived forever. History is the living evidence. We can see no one can live forever. And if this goes on, however best we may have done our actions, if we are born again, then out of our ignorance, we may again commit the same faults, do the same wrongs, maybe little less, maybe more, as we have been doing in this life or in earlier lives. So, they think immortality, that is our goal. We don't want to be born again and again. They are the people who want mukti, just live as souls, not to become corporeal, come into flesh and blood. And they think this is the goal of every spiritual person. But this also goal can be achieved only with the help and guidance of God, because all other human beings themselves are mortal. So anyone who is himself mortal, how can he make others immortal? If he were capable of doing it, he should have first of all been able to immortalize himself. But we don't find any evidence to that extent. So therefore they say, "God who is immortal," indirectly meaning thereby that they consider God as the knowledgeful, the immortal, who never comes in the cycle of birth and death, never dies. He is above death, eternal. And then also that he knows the reality. There are many kinds of realities. People have tried to classify how many realities there are, depending upon the dimension, the angle, the parameters with which you look at things. Things which appear to you to be real are in fact not real. Our mind plays a deceptive role. Sometimes we think this is this, but actually this is not this. It is the opposite of it. So our conclusions, our decisions, our understanding has all these flaws. And God alone can lead us to reality. Some people distinguish between reality and truth, not going into the details of it. What is the difference between reality and truth? But reality is also connected with realization. And even if it were truth and reality were the same thing, then we want to realize the truth. That should become a reality. Only the theoretical aspect of it, and if we have not experienced it, then that perhaps also we don't think it's reality. Sometimes you will find during our conversations, somebody tells us something which looks to be strange, a little bit, more or less, unbelievable. We say, Really? Really? He says, yes, really. You see, it means he is convinced that what he is saying is the final truth. So even if there is truth, there is transcendental truth, there is mundane truth, truth also changes from time to time. In different contexts, different things are true. Poison is poison, but for a certain diseased person, poison is a medicine. What is the reality? Is a particular thing a medicine or a reality? So in the case of one person, the reality is that that person is medicine, curative. And in the case of another person, that is very deadly. It's written on the bottle, its container, keep it away from children. Please use it with the instructions of the doctor only. Don't take it on your own, because it's poisonous. So, what is the reality? Because without understanding the reality and realizing the reality, we cannot have final liberation. That moment of bliss, that deep peace, being with ourselves, we cannot have this kind of a goal achieved in our life if we don't know the reality. The reality must dawn upon us. Then only the crust which is settled on the soul, which is preventing it from having its original shine, will break. And we will be again attaining our original stage. So there are so many things which are obstacles in our way. Because there are certain things which are psychological errors, psychological barriers. And those barriers and errors, psychological faults, the mind is made of a different stuff. The brain is made of a different stuff. And the mind is loaded with negativities, prejudices, for example, bias, selfishness, so many blemishes, so many bad things it is carrying with it. So mind as an instrument of knowledge, as an instrument of reality, in this present state, is not perfect. How can therefore you know the reality? How can you weigh a particular thing and say accurately that its weight is this, unless your weighing machine is correct? If the weighing machine itself is not giving the proper weight, so the instrument being wrong, the thing can be otherwise. Once a person used a thermometer, and the thermometer gave the temperature 120, you see. So that person should have died long ago. So it couldn't be. But the mercury in the thermometer, or the thermometer itself, whatever it contained, was faulty. So that man got the temperature, even if he did not have it, by reading the thermometer giving so much of temperature, you see. So the instrument must be correct. So how can the instrument be correct? The mind itself, by its own power, cannot correct itself, because it has so many negativities. It has inbuilt faults, certain things which are in contradiction to each other. There is always a conflict in the mind, to be or not to be, to do or not to do. So within a lifespan, one is not able to set even the instrument correct. So God alone can help us. So therefore the bhaktas say, lead us from darkness to light, from mortality to immortality, and from unreality, or from untruth, or from falsehood, to reality, truth, or what is factual, what is accurate, correct. So they also have some values. They think these are the ultimate values. All other values are governed by it. If you just try to find out why you want honesty, why you want sincerity, why you want cooperation, what for? These are just on the path. They are in between our point of start and our ultimate goal. In order to attain ultimately a different objective, And the objective, ultimate objective, they say, is immortality and light and knowing the truth. Everything is for this. But wittingly or unwittingly, consciously or unconsciously, knowingly or unknowingly, man is trying to assault another values. They are values for attaining ultimately these values. Therefore, having concluded this philosophically and also with whatever understanding some people have, they pray to God for this, some bhaktas. That is what they seek for. Then there are others, to them there are the other values. They say, God is Satyam Shivam Sundaram. He is Satyam. He is truth personified, epitome of truth. Truth and truth alone, unallied truth, truth, eternal truth, which never gets mixed up with other, the negative of it. God is such a kind of truth, holistic truth also, not pigeonholes of truth, fragmentary truth. So God is truth, Satyam, and Shivam, because if you know the truth, but if it is not for the benefit of others, you are not benevolent, you are not benefactor, what is your truth for? The truth, by its very nature, reaches others. Even if they don't reach you, it goes out to help others. So God is such a truth, the only one. He is also the world benefactor, not the benefactor of a few people. He wants to give the benefit to all. Therefore, Baba always said, whenever you write the attributes of God, just write all with it. Yesterday I said, he said, use the prefix ever, ever happy, ever healthy, ever wealthy, so on. But he also said, use for all. Peace, God gives peace. Not say God gives peace. There are human beings who also give peace to some people. They are given world peace. They are Nobel laureates in that field. Perhaps they make some sincere efforts for peace. Number one, that peace is not lasting. Number two, it is not holistic. Other things are lacking. Number three, it is not for all. But God is Shivam. He gives you peace. Not only peace, but also bliss and enthusiasm and whatever is needed to make you peaceful. Peace also is dependent on so many other things. So he gives you all these things forever and ever. And also to all. He gives it to all. He has no reservations. For example, some people want to give benefit to Hindus, to Muslims. There are certain trusts for Muslims, for Christians, for Hindus, for certain castes and cults. God is for all. He is Shivam. Let everyone get the benefit he wants to give to all. And Sundaram, he is the eternal beauty. They say beauty is that which is joy forever. Today a person is looking very beautiful, his face. Tomorrow he has so many wrinkles on his face. He gets an accident and something on his face makes him ugly. Or there is a disease which causes some changes in the man and they come out on his face. Or even if his face is beautiful, his mind is not beautiful. He shouts, he is angry. He is a short-tempered person, always showing such signs on face that you are afraid. So you can't enjoy the beauty of his face. And moreover, our face is full of holes. Previously they thought that moon is beautiful, but now they know how beautiful it is. Similarly, if you look at the face with a microscope, you will see how many holes it has. And who are dwelling in the holes? So many germs and so many viruses or whatever, you see. Particles of dust, sweat and other things. It is not beautiful. A thing which is really beautiful, eternally beautiful and handsome, virtuous, always, ever and ever, is God. Not subject to the vagaries of time, subject to certain other variant factors which will destroy or demolish or say change its beauty, you see, make it ugly. No. Perfectly beautiful. Most beautiful, you see. So he has those qualities. So these are the values. Why people go to cinemas to see the movies, to gardens, do this, do that, and other things for pleasure, for enjoying the beauty of nature. Go by a lakeside, go to a place where there's a lot of green, there are flowers, so on and so forth. So man is either after beauty or he is after truth. If a friend of you tells you falsehood, you say, from today I won't talk to you. You have deceived me. You tell lies. That means you want truth. You believe in truth. Someone who does not tell you the truth, they say he is a cheat. He deceives. What happened in the case of Clinton? Why the Senate and the Congress was after him, you see. They say he committed perjury on oath. He told lies. Even after taking oath, official oath, before the judiciary, you see, jurists. So, truth. If you just go deeper into it, you will find man wants truth, you see. And something which is good. That good is Shivam. Not bad. Not something which gives us a bad feeling. And also Sundaram, beautiful. And they think these are the qualities inherent in God. He is full of them forever and forever. And he is not only having all those qualities forever, but he shares it with others. He blesses others with this. There are people who have money. They are selfish people. The money lies in the banks and they leave their body. It is not used either for their own benefit or for others. What for is their money? They are rich people, multimillionaire or billionaire, but what is all that wealth for? Useless, you see. There are many poor people, there are many diseased people, there are many uneducated people. They didn't spend even a single penny on them, any one of them. What is the use? But God says, my dear children, my everything is for you, inexhaustible. I have so much, so much, so much, that I would never say there is no more, I am exhausted, finished. Whatever I had, I have distributed. It is for you to get it. And I will go on giving it and giving it forever, you see. So such are the qualities of God, and therefore they worship God because of these qualities. And then others say there is some morality, some moral law, some moral principles in this world. Honesty, for example. If someone is dishonest, you don't like it. If someone is insincere, you don't like it. If someone has ego and has no humility, you don't like it. So there are some values which you like. And those values make the life happy. Without those values, life is not worth living. We want to build a society which is value-based. Because that is what the function of values is. Values make the life happy, healthy. It gives us so much. So, that is essential. But the question is, there can be relativity so far as values are concerned. Some people think that Muhammad, he was the last prophet, the greatest on earth that ever was. And they believe in Sunnah. Sunnah means they read the biography and the life story of Muhammad, what he did in certain situations, how he behaved, how he acted, and they find that what are the values which he manifested in his life when in flesh and blood, and therefore there is a law, Islamic law, which is Sunnah. And they generally have Islamic law. They think that is the best because Muhammad was having all those moral values. Others say, no, no, Christ. Just read about him. He has all those values. Christ has those values. Others say Buddha. That is why there are so many religions. It is not only because of the beliefs. Belief system is one thing, but the other system is the ethical one, the moral thing. So it is relative. Someone believes in Christ, other one in Nanak, other one in others, Shankaracharya or maybe anyone else. The question therefore is, what is the absolute value? In mathematics, in algebra, in coordinate geometry, you know, they make a graph, they draw x, they draw on a piece of paper, x is x and y axis, intersecting ether, and that point of intersection is called origin, you see, x axis, y axis. That is how we find out the latitude and longitude of a particular place on the map. Its geographical location. So it is in relative to something. So we say this thing is in the north. What do you mean by in the north? Kashmir, for example, is in north. North as in reference to or in relevance to Delhi. But if you think of China, Kashmir is not in north, it is in south. Mount Abu, there may be a place in the west, because you are comparing it with some other place which is in the east. So that is how you talk of things. There is not only theory of relativity in physics, but theory of relativity in moral field, in ethics. These things are relative. But honesty, humility, sincerity, cooperation are these values. Who is the origin? The referral point to whom you should refer, because there is controversy otherwise. And even those persons whom we consider as the ideal ones, the role models before us, like Muhammad, Dayanand, Nanak and others, even they believed in God, thinking that God has those values. They think that they also got those values from God. So they ultimately reach the conclusion, God is the most, is the highest moral being, the holiest of the holy, the most perfect one in regard to the purity, the purest one. So they think that we must know God and the mind of God and the values as they are ingrained in Him, inherent in Him. Without that, we can't understand the morality completely, because they differ from country to country, religion to religion, culture to culture, tradition to tradition. So how you are going to determine what is good and what is bad? Some people say, take meat. Others say, don't take meat. Why we should not take meat? Because you kill others and you must therefore have vegetarian diet, you must not commit violence. And others say, this is not violence. If you don't do it, then the number of the hens and lambs and others, that would go on increasing and so on. They have different arguments. What are we going to do and to believe in? You see, ultimately, God is the referral point, so far as morality is concerned. He can ultimately tell us what is the truth. Human beings, they say celibacy is a good thing. That is why bishops, the fathers in the church, the nuns, those who are committed to Christianity, they follow celibacy, virginity. They think it is a great virtue. Others, for example, in other religions, they say it is not necessary. I don't know whether you know it or not, Muhammad had more than 20 wives. You see. So what do you mean by celibacy? If he is the perfect ideal before you, But he was not celibate, you see. He married even the wife of one of his disciples, you see. And he did so many things. They said he can do anything because he was a man of God. And God made him, you see, to do this, to do that and everything. They justify it like that. So others say, no, therefore we don't believe in Islam. Others say, no, we must believe. Even otherwise also there is promiscuity and people in a hidden form commit this adultery and all this for one reason or the other. So he did it openly. What is wrong with him? They want to justify. So what ultimately is right, you see, celibacy and virginity, or live a householder's life, have one wife, maybe two issues, one son and one daughter or whosoever, not more than that. So what is the norm? How you decide? God alone can give us the final truth about morality, about the ethical values. Therefore, they worship God. Some others, they say they don't know why they want to seek God, to pray to Him, to invoke Him. But somehow they find that they have love for God. Why they have love for God? They also don't know why. But they say inwardly there is a feeling that we love God. And we have sometimes experience in our life that God also loves us. This is why we worship Him, why we want to know Him. So for them there is no other argument, no other reason of belief or disbelief, of why they worship or other things. They don't want to enter into any arguments. The only reason for them is that they have love for God. Why they have love for God? They say, why do you love rose? You love it because you love it. That's it. So we love God because we love God. Oh, you want to know even the reason of love. Everywhere you want to know the reason, you see. Ultimately, there is no reason for the original reason, you see. There is some place, some point of time where you have to stop your reasoning. Then otherwise it becomes in circle, circuitous. Therefore, they say that love is love. It is a sentiment, it is a feeling, it is a bias of the mind. You naturally feel drawn towards someone without you are knowing why you do it. But you do it. It is a fact. Therefore, we worship God because we love Him. Therefore, and they think that God is loveful. For them, the greatest value is love. And therefore, they worship God thinking that He is the loveful. They perhaps are heartbroken people, shipwrecks. They loved perhaps this man or that woman or this child or that boy or this friend or that friend, and he ultimately deceived him or she deceived him. His heart is perhaps broken and he finds that there are shocks in life. The person whom you love so much, you are fond of a person so much, that person a time comes when he does not love you. So they seek now someone who loves them forever and whose love is above selfishness, you see. Perhaps that is the reason why they worship God, why they want to know God. But whatever the reason is, that they love God. Then others, they say God is truth, consciousness and bliss. These are the three attributes for which we worship God. He is truth personified. They say Sat, Chit, Anand. Sat, Chit, Anand. Sat means existence. Even the material has existence. Sat has two meanings. One meaning is existence. The other meaning is truth. Matter exists. It is true. It exists. Then matter does not have consciousness and it does not have bliss. there are souls, living beings in corporeal form. They are Sat and Chit. They exist and they have consciousness, awareness, self-awareness, self-consciousness. They are not only conscious of the material existence, but they are also conscious of themselves, that they are. The main thing with human beings is that they are self-aware. I am. What am I thinking? Rightly or wrongly, and so on. This self-awareness, memory, judgment, the other things, emotions, all these constitute consciousness. So, the soul, they have consciousness besides the existence. And they also don't have bliss. Or if they have bliss today, tomorrow they may not have it. Now there, but we find that some people have happiness in life. Some yogis, some high-souled persons, mahatmas, saints, sages and seers, they enjoy some bliss. In the earlier part of their life, they did not have it. But maybe presently when we come in touch with them, we find that they have bliss. But they did not have it earlier. And it is not full bliss, it is growing. Today they have bliss, tomorrow it may be more or it may be less. But God is the one who is ever blissful. No disturbance in Him. And therefore they want bliss. They say bliss is the greatest achievement. In for them, in the whole value system, some say players, the principle of player is basic for them in ethics. You do in order to seek players. Now, they are one type of people. Others for other things, power. Nietzsche, for example, existentialist, they say man is for power. Karl Marx said, no, man is for money. Freud said, no, man is for sex. So they think one thing or the other thing is the desideratum, the factor which moves them all. One thought in their mind, that is their goal. Man is moved by any one of these. Now, if they want sex, perhaps they think it gives them pleasure or bliss. If they want power, they also think that they feel better when they have power. Actually, what they want to seek is bliss, but they don't know it. What for you want power? There will be so many problems if you have power. But they want power thinking that they will be in a better position. They will feel better. To feel better always, without any ups and downs, any disturbances, and having some kind of a happiness which is not dependent on power, on sex, on money, and so on. There can be so many other factors, people have said variously, various authors and thinkers. Bliss is that quality of life, that experience which is the highest, not depending upon money, not depending on power, not depending on anything worldly or material, on human beings, on relations, on certain circumstances. No. It is such thing. And they say this is the greatest achievement in life. And God is the one who has existence, consciousness, bliss, Sat Chit Anand Swaroop. What do you mean by Swaroop? Banana is sweet. There may be other kinds of fruit which also are sweet. Dates. We eat dates. Dates also are sweet. Certain kinds of tolis are given to us in Madhuban, sweet. But there are certain things which are by their very nature nothing but sweet. Take for example the sugar crystals. Sugar crystals are nothing but sweet, you see. Whatever part of them you put into your mouth, you get that sweet taste. But other things may be sweet mixed with something. Not sweetness pure and simple. allied sweetness. But sugar crystals, because crystal is that form in chemistry in which things become pure in their nature, in their form. So they are crystallized, they become pure, pure sugar. And that is Swaroop. Swaroop means nothing but, nothing allied, not mixed up. You see, so God is Swaroop, blissful. It is not that his, not only his bliss does not depend on anything, but his bliss is unalloyed, unmixed, pure and simple. Nothing, they, we say, we will speak the truth and nothing but truth, though they speak the falsehood and nothing but falsehood. But while taking the oath in the court, they say, to the best of my knowledge and belief, whatever I will say the truth. And you see this, actually they do the opposite. When they file an affidavit or take an oath, they swear by something, but actually they do the opposite thing. But nothing but, I was saying, in this case, is God. God is nothing but bliss. So if we want that kind of experience, unto which kind of experience even the kingdom of the whole world has no value. The kingdom at best can give you certain players, some wealth, some subjects who are obedient to you, a big territory to rule upon, so many things, but not bliss. Anyone who has tasted this bliss, he would be prepared to give up everything but to make and have this bliss. If somebody asks another one, you see, they say that when Alexander came to India, it's in the history books, when Alexander came to him, his guru, I think he was Aristotle, and he had asked him, you see, Alexander asked him what gift he should bring for him from India. He said, a yogi. You see, I want an Indian yogi, if you can bring him, you see. So after fighting, when he found little time, he asked people to search for a yogi. Yogi in those days, not Raj Yogi, Brahma Kumar, but some that kind of yogi. On the hilltop, he was doing that kind of yoga, not transcendental meditation, some other kind of yoga. So they approached him that Alexander wants you to accompany him. It's a great honor, you should accept. And what are your demands? He is prepared to fulfill. Tell us how much money you require, this and all that. Whatever your facilities, you say, we fulfill. You see, we want to take you. He said, but why? Why should I go? Please, I am in bliss. If anybody wants this bliss, let him come here. I am prepared to share with him. I don't want money. I don't want patronage of high persons. I don't want somebody to glorify me, to praise me. What for should I go? If someone feels needy, let him come to me. I am prepared to serve him. So that yogi, not a Raj Yogi, we who are in touch, in link with Shiv Baba, meditating and having that experience, if when we are in that stage of Bindurup Sthiti, that seed stage, and feeling that I am light and might, nothing but light and might, no body, no physical environment, no other thought, me and Baba, we two of us, and even two of us not talking but experiencing, you see, I am fulfilled. I don't want anything else. Nothing in the world is required. The first result will be, I have no ambition, you see. Ichha matram avidya, Baba says, you should have no desires. When God is giving you everything, so much, why should you have desires? No desire. Because actually the main desire of everyone is bliss. They don't know it. They are seeking it either as pleasures, sensual pleasures, or through other kinds of things. But if you just try to, it's a long thing, you see, long process. Philosophically, if I were to take up certain kinds of things which a human being is seeking for, you will find ultimately he wants something different. He is not actually happy. Someone has a favorite dish, certain kinds of vegetables, certain kinds of fruits, certain kinds of juices, and so on. You give him something, he says, "Waha, you see, so I'm so happy. I really relished it. Nice experience, you see." If you tell him, "Please have some more," he will say, "No more." But why? When this is making you happy, the more of it should make you more happy, isn't it? Why it is not making you more happy? He says, no, I am full. You see, I don't want any more of it. So it has limitations. And it is not real bliss. They say a dog had a bone in the mouth. It was trying to chew the bone, piece of bone. There is a saying, if you want the dog to start barking, give a bone to him. He will play with the bone or put it into his mouth. And when he puts the bone into his mouth, naturally he will stop barking. Why he is fond of bone, the dog? When he has the bone in his mouth, he tries to chew it, and the result is that his gums are injured. The blood comes out of it. He thinks he is tasting blood. He feels very happy. Good experience. He feels it is bliss. You see, that is the dark bliss he is having, not the yogic bliss. The poor fellow does not know that it is his own blood. The bone is actually giving him nothing, you see. It is only injuring his gums, you see. He does not know the reality, why he is getting this, you see. So even if somebody feels very happy by getting this kind of pleasure, that kind of pleasure, pleasure of the eyes, the ears, the nose, they have different sources of pleasure. You will find, in reality, this person wants that kind of pleasure which is more refined, higher, for which he has not to depend upon others, which are not harmful ultimately. These ultimately, they say, when you eat, the food also eats you. In Sanskrit, the food is called annam, ann. Ann has two meanings: that which you eat and that which eats you. So I don't know, when you eat the food, whether you think the food also eats you. How the food eats us? Because when you take the food, your teeth, your taste buds, your stomach, you see, so many things come into action. Your organs begin to play their part. There is wear and tear. You are growing, losing energy. For eating food, digesting food, eliminating the wastage of it. So it is not only that you eat the food also eats you to an extent. So all kinds of pleasures ultimately are not the things forever, the bliss forever. God alone is the one who gives the bliss forever. Therefore, those bhaktas, those worshippers seek bliss. Therefore, they want to invoke God. Oh God, give us bliss, they say. Those who understand what bliss is. Some others think God gives security. You see, they are security conscious. Security is one of the human needs, very important, you see. Some people are afraid, someone chasing them, following them, pursuing them. The world is bad. You see, there are so many cases reported in the newspapers. They become cautious. Now, others' kind of securities fail. At the proper moment when we require them, they fail. Indira Gandhi had a lot of security. And most of you must be knowing, it were her security people who killed her, shot at her. Her death occurred because those who were her bodyguards or the belonged to her security force, they gunned her down. So, even otherwise also, you may have, there are certain persons, you see, and they are armed, they are to go with you wherever you go. The government has provided you with security, but for a while they have gone for something. You ask them to bring this thing or that thing, and in the meantime somebody shoots at you, you see. They can't be always with you, and other people, they may kill even the security guards. The security guards are not the perfect security, they are also human beings, they also have a risk. God can reach anywhere and He can give you perfect security. How? He can touch that person, you see. The main thing is someone is thinking of killing you. But if his thought changes that he should not kill you, he cannot kill you. Even if he has the gun, he had the intention to kill, but now that his mind is changed, so he cannot kill. God can do that. Human beings can't do that. So therefore they think God is the perfect security. You see, He can reach anywhere, He can help anywhere, He is almighty. And He can change the mind of a person, and this is the task which no one else can do. Therefore, they think of God and pray to Him. That He is providing them security for life. Rakshak, as they say. He is our Rakshak. Therefore, they want to surrender to Him. My Lord, my Father, O my most beloved one, my God, I surrender myself to you. I take shelter into you. You are to take care of my security. I am your child. So I am now under your umbrella. You are to protect me. You are the one who are capable of and competent for protecting me. So that gives them a good feeling. God takes care of me. You see. And there are so many stories, you see, how certain persons were saved because they believed in God, thinking that God would help them. He does help. And having learned those stories from those people who had this kind of experience, they think it is worth. We should remember God, pray to Him. Then others think they want to know the future. Even when some people meet you, meet Baap Dada, meet senior sisters, Dadis, they will say, Dadiji, what is our future? You see, you also perhaps, not perhaps, but surely, you want to know what you will be in golden age. Perhaps you don't find someone who can tell you, otherwise you will approach that person and think of standing even in a queue to get this confirmed information, whether you will become Lakshmi, Narayan, son or daughter or descendant, what will you become in golden age? That you will go to golden age is sure, because now you are linked to Baba, obeying Him. But what you will be in golden age, you see, you want to know, every one of you? I can tell you. Because Baba keeps His files with me, you see. So they all want to know, you see, the future. And they think God alone knows the past, the present and the future. And He alone can tell, you see, Trikal Darshi. He is the knower of the past, present and future, Trikal Darshi. No other one is Trikal Darshi. So many people now read the prophecies of Nostradamus and others. They think he predicted so many things. Others, like Isaiah in Testament. Similarly, other prophets, they are called prophets because they prophesied, they predicted. And people think they were saints because they think they predicted, they had that ability. They were God-men, you see, so to say. But God Himself has this quality. He is Trikaldarshi. And therefore, they want to know the future. Therefore, they go to astronomers, astrologers, and to palmists, to other such like allied systems to know what their future will be, you see. Because man wants to know the future. God alone can tell the future. So therefore, they worship God that He might bless them some vision, give them some kind of a revelation, some kind of a premonition, so that they can peep into the future, know their future. So these are some of the reasons for which the bhaktas worship God. Now, before I proceed further, I would like to tell you what Baba has to say about bhaktas, about philosophers, about agnostics, about the various arguments. I had told you yesterday also certain things, but I have said certain things in today's session, and in referring to that, I would say, what are the proofs for which, on the basis of which, Baba gives us the belief that God exists? Before you experience God and you practically realize, you want to know, you have to have knowledge, convincing knowledge, that God exists, you see. So there are, as I told you, the argument from design, the argument from systems, and so on and so forth. But what are the arguments that God gives? Now I'll tell you that. Which are very particular to only our system, which no other person has ever touched. They have given different proofs, which perhaps are not valid. That is why there is controversy. But Baba has given us certain other proofs, altogether a different category, you see, provided someone understands it. Now, one of these is, Baba says you can see the religions, Christianity, who founded Christianity, Christ, Buddhism, there are Buddhists, who founded Buddhism, Buddha, Jainism, yes, Jainism, who founded Jainism, Mahavir, so on and so forth. Muslim religion, Muhammad. Jewish religion, our some sisters and brothers say Abraham. I would say Moses, you see. But whatever it may be, these religions were founded by someone. They have a founder. That is the father of their religion. They call them father, the father of the religion. Even now, they call the bishop in the church as their godfather. Though he is not the founder, but someone who takes care of their moral and spiritual progress because of that reason. As a father looks after a child's well-being, so does the head of a church take care of the people, those who come there. So, they have founders. They are called fathers. But Baba says, besides that, there is another religion. That religion has lost its original name, but it exists. Though in a changed form, in a degenerated form, in a deteriorated form, it exists. It is called Hinduism. Therefore, people don't know its founder, its father. That is the ancient most and the original religion. He gives us the illustration of tree, the roots, which was the ancient religion. This Christianity, Buddhism, Sikhism, Islam, Shankaracharya, they are the offshoots, the branches and the sub-branches. But the root, what is that religion? Baba says that is the original religion of gods and goddesses, devis and devtas. Not going into the detail of it, that can be explained at length. There are proofs. There was a time when people did not believe in gods and goddesses. But now, for example, the book on chariots of gods, someone has written about paradise. He has collected what the tradition of every religion says about paradise. It was here on earth. They have given so many other proofs to say that once upon a time on this very earth, there lived people who were much higher as compared to the people today, in terms of morality, in terms of their lifestyle, the virtues, the qualities they had, you see. Devis and Devtas. Even when we read the Old Testament, there is mention, the sons of God married the daughters of men. Have you ever noticed? The sons of God married the daughters of men. There came a time when still there were some gods and goddesses. They had become a vanishing tribe. And now the people who lived, they were men. Though great among men, but no longer they had those divine qualities as their ancestors had. Devis and Devtas, they were not like them. So they think that, therefore it has been said, the sons of God, gods with G small, Devtas, the sons of gods married the daughters of men, you see. If you want, I can give you the verse and the chapter and so on. So it's very much mentioned. I discussed it with so many Christians who are their preachers, proselytizers and others. What does it mean? Who were the sons of gods? Who were the daughters of men? How both came in contact? What was the time, the age, the period? They are not able to explain. They have certain institutions which publish certain things and distribute among the people, the Bible and other books, you see, by different names. Worldwide, they have their branches. I went to them also to ask, you see, because they have their own seminaries. I said, you discuss it among them, and what your scholars say, let me know, you see. No, they don't know. It was the beginning of Copper Age, end of Silver Age. You just read the Old Testament, this person, that person, then that person, then that person. He lived for so many years, he lived for so many years. By that time you will find the Copper Age came. And then at that time they say, the sons of gods married the daughters of women, you see. I told them, they said, maybe, we do not know. So that was the Copper Age. Baba says this was the religion of Adam and Eve. You believe in Adam and Eve. He was the father of the human race. Great, 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 great grandfather of humanity. But who was the father of Adam? Who created Adam? You see. So there are Dharmapita, fathers of religion, and there is Parampita, Supreme Father. Because this process goes on, and even those Indologists and other people who have done worldwide research in languages, the German language, the Scandinavians, the French language, English language, Italian language, and so on, they find there are common words which are used day to day. Sugar, water, sister, brother, father, mother, house, these things, they have the common words. They are derived one from the other. They have been changed if the Aryans have gone out of India from one country to other country, it can be explained how this word became elephant. Elephant. The word in Sanskrit is what? And when they went to Persia, what word it became? When they went to France, what it was? There the T was silent. It did not, it had no, I mean, fen. Then it became fent. They went to the country where T was vocal. They have written books and books on it, you see. If one can give so much of evidence from various fields to say, gone are the days when people used to say that the ancestors of men lived in caves and jungles. They were hunters and gatherers. Once upon a time, this theory came into existence and it had been spread. But now, there are people who believe that there was an earlier civilization. There are carvings, stone carvings, so deep, ornamental carvings, so artistic. Even the, you see, the Egyptian pyramids. Some of you who have visited Cairo, how big the stones are, how bulky, how weighty, how they were moved, where from they were brought, what was the system of transport, had they cranes, did they bring it by some kind of a transport, which is non-existence today. Then the vimans and other things are mentioned. And the formulas, lately they have found a book, a manuscript, in which how vimans are made, what fuel is used, how they fly, so on and so forth, it has been found out. Many things in museums lying unexplored, people didn't go through them. They were invading countries, destroying the museums, the libraries, and trying to say that their civilization is better, others are just ignorant people, and so on. Now, briefly saying that there was a religion called Adi Sanatan Devi Devata Dharma, the religions of gods and goddesses. Who was the founder of it? The same whom you call Adam, he was called Brahma, Prajapita. So Dharmapita, so many Dharmapita, fathers of religions. Then Prajapita, who is the great-great-grandfather, like Adam, of all, from which all other religions emanated, and Parampita, the Supreme Soul. Baba says actually there are four fathers. One is your Laukik father, the father of your body, the other the father of your religion, the other great-great-grandfather, that is Prajapita, and then Parampita, you see. He says, else how can you explain who founded that religion and who was his father, who created him? In the story of creation, the Genesis, it's mentioned, in the beginning there was the world and so on, the world floated on waters whatsoever, and then God created man out of dust, clay, and then he put the soul through the nostrils into that person, he became the Adam. Then from one of his ribs, he made the Eve. Without any explanation, without any biological basis, that a person is born only from one rib, you see. In New York once, after a seminar, we were in a place where we were to eat something. By my side was sitting a bishop. Who was the head of a department of biology in a particular university. So since I generally don't talk when I'm eating, but in the West it is a fashion that when you are sitting you must not keep silent, you must speak. Otherwise they think that he does not want to reveal his ignorance, he is a foolish person, therefore he does not speak. He is very dry, very so on and so forth. So willingly or unwillingly I began to speak to him. But what should I say to him? This man is, you see, bishop, and he belongs to Christianity. So I happened to ask him, sir, I wanted to know one thing. Since your background is a biology, physiology, the mention about Adam, you see, how old was Adam when he was created? Just a baby or a person of 7 years, 8 years, 10 years, you see. He was created as a man or a boy or a baby, you see, I want to know. Then the breath or the spirit was infused into that body of atom afterwards. But they say if the brain does not get oxygen for so many minutes, it becomes dead. Sir, how is it that Adam was living, you see? Didn't it become a dead body? How could it be revived? You see, what kind of treatment they gave to Adam so that he was furious. You see, I thought that I have made it difficult for him to eat. eat anything. So I said, forget about it, let's talk about something. I thought he is a proper person because he is of the head of department. I said, how you explain this to your students, Christian students who are believers? I just wanted to know. But if you mind it, please forget about it, you see. Because they have no explanation, it is a blind faith. But Adam was created, as it is mentioned in the story of creation. How it was created, they don't know. God created, they say that. Who is God who created it? How he created it? They don't know. And therefore they say there was clay, as if he made a tie, and into the tie he infused something, and this is funny, you see. At least I can't believe it. Some of you maybe, I don't know. So, but Baba says that this was the original religion, and this Prajapita, and Dharmapita, and that Parapita. That is how he gives one of the proofs in the existence of God. Then he shows us the illustration of tree. Very logical. It sums up the whole history. I hope that Sister Jayanti remembers when I came to London for the first time, she had asked us whom we wanted to meet. I had suggested one of the names, Bertrand Russell, you see. He had written 60 volumes on history. One of the very topmost persons on world history. And he was the advisor to the British government because of his background of history of nations, how they should have relations with various nations, what are the historical backgrounds of those nations, and so on. Considered to be a very knowledgeable person. He had perhaps given us some 20 minutes or so. I don't know how Baba touched him, you see, so that he fixed up that appointment. Earlier, we had learned that Pandit Nehru, Jawaharlal Nehru, had requested for an interview, for meeting him, for an appointment. But he did not give. He was a very busy person, very busy person. But because of Sister Jayanti's efforts, Baba's grace, he made our visit fruitful to some extent, and then we were able to meet him. We showed him the world tree. He was amazed. We also showed him that world wheel, and it is very fantastic, he said, full of wisdom. These were his remarks. We wanted to have a photograph with us. Ramesh Bhai was taking photographs. That was the first man interviewed, and he took photographs. And at the end of it, he said there are no photographs because there was a hole in the camera, light entered, and there was no photograph. You see? Okay. I don't know what sort of camera it was. It was a very important thing. If you meet a historian of this type, and you just recalled, if you had something which recalled his views. Now from 20 minutes, he went on to about 45 minutes or more, asking questions. We told him about destruction, about golden age, other things very clearly. Let us give him message, whatever his beliefs are. And he felt very happy with whatever we said. We presented a set of those pictures to him. And after that, when I had been traveling to other countries, I used to read some articles contributed by him. He had not mentioned our names, but he had mentioned that some of the things which we had mentioned to him. I was very happy. I thought when I go back to India, I keep in touch with him, write to him. That also didn't happen because, I don't say why. What was the cause? There are so many causes, some of them worth revealing, others not worth revealing. This is one of the latter category. Okay. But after that, that man passed away, we lost an opportunity. If such a historian had favored our view, had written something in his books, it would have been very valuable. But what I wanted to say was, even he did not contradict it. Because in his history books, he has said that the history is of 6,000 years, you see, human history. People talk of natural history, how there was explosion, you know, that Big Bang, and from that onwards and so on. Then the primordial soup, then the amoeba came up. From amoeba to ape to man, they say is the natural history, history of nature. Thereafter comes man on the scene. To that, he believed that there were 6,000 years, not more than that. At least the human civilization, if not the human beings, were not older than 6,000 years. Now, in this period, this is the oldest religion. Leave aside other proofs, because there are devis and devatas found in all religions. You go to Tokyo and other parts of Japan, there are pictures and stone statues of Saraswati, Brahma, others in Indonesia, Malaysia, Cambodia. Many countries where I visited, I tried to find out. There are. I have some of the copies. Others have collected so many. In your own country, if you just go deeper into this study, you will find that they remember there were some devis and devatas. You see. This religion was established by someone. Now Baba, speaking of the tree, he says the seed has the knowledge of the whole tree. In its genetic system, the growth of the whole tree is dormant. It is lying latent in potential form. Later on it grows and grows as it finds the proper atmosphere, the nourishment, the care, and so on. But what will it grow into? In those days when there was no discovery of the gene, which Khurana did it for the first time, an Indian in America, who was given the Nobel Prize. From that time to this time, there is a lot of, understanding about the genes, the genetic system, so that nowadays we are talking of genetic engineering, and that the diseases also should be treated by treatment of the genes. The human species also may be improved by manipulating the genes, and so on. Genes are such a thing. Baba said, the seeds have that kind of a potential, or dormant or latent ability, which later on makes them manifest in the form of a tree. So the seed has the whole knowledge of the tree. Baba used to say, if the seed could speak, if he knew the language, seed, speak to you, then it could tell you what branch will come up when. So comparing this analogy, in physics, one of the proofs is analogy. You try to prove many things by analogy. So Baba said, this world is the tree, God is the seed. This is the analogy. If you believe in the world, you tell us what is the analogy. What do you compare the world with? If we tell you your analogy is false, your whole philosophy falls to the ground. It is the perfect analogy where the relationship between the world and God is that of seed and the tree. Eternal tree, kalpa tree, you see. And the seed, the eternal seed, who has the knowledge. Therefore, he knows the past, the present, and the future. God knows, and therefore he comes and explains. And the tree also has this. So he wants to know, if you don't believe in God, the world is like a tree. Just see its evolution, its development. You can make a tree of psychology. How psychology started. What are its branches and sub-branches. A tree of philosophy. So many trees you can make in different systems.